Okay, I have, like Sonia had mentioned, the exposures that all of you report and put on the website. Each year has changed, and this change is somewhat twofold. One of it is, like Sonia mentioned, our reinsurance company CRL has asked us to collect some information and kind of to change the format. So we've made some changes to accommodate our reinsurance company, but also we have made changes to try to make it a little easier, a little more user friendly, to take a little bit of the reporting process off of your plate. So hopefully some of the changes are beneficial as far as time goes for you guys. And so I have to apologize for the next slide. I know, with all these presentations, everybody has this kind of catch at the beginning. Alex showed the office clip that was hilarious, and Johnny showed pictures of him, and Corby has attorney jokes, and Chris, I'll help you file the claim later. So I'm just kidding. So this is what I have for my first page. Report. So if that doesn't make you excited about the next 15 or 20 minutes, I don't know what will. So if we move to the changes, if somebody, just in a nutshell, if somebody could tell me, what is exposure reporting? As you've worked on the USIP website to gather and collect the information, how would you sum it up? Any of you that how would you sum up exposure reporting with your experience? What is it?
I would just say it's like a snapshot of what our exposures are, like in general, like what we want insured, but what all the information that we have that would be good for our insurance to know so that we cover our bases.
Absolutely. So that's perfect. Perfect. Thank you. So you have, of course, vehicles, right? Buildings, contents coverage, the amount of employees, total expenditures, right? How much money is coming through, kind of passing through the county or special service district or health department. So these are just a few reasons. So we know what exposure reporting is, of course, but these are a few of the purposes. The main purpose, of course, is we collect and gather that information, and just like it says, if really for rating purposes, is a top priority. The exposures data, so the amount of vehicles, the amount of employees, the amount of law enforcement that you have determines the USIP member contribution. And so the second phase of that, it also determines reinsurance premiums. So I'm sure many of you are familiar with, if you have a policy, say with a major insurance company, they insure a portion of that, but they have an insurance company that insures them. So it's essentially an insurance company insuring an insurance company. We are similar to that too with the structure of USIP. We have a certain threshold to where USIP will pay out of those member contributions. And then if it gets beyond a certain layer, we will go to our reinsurance company who takes the risk from that point and they run with it. And so it's with insurance, with the pool, it's somewhat twofold. So we also determine off of your exposures the reinsurance premiums. The second one is it helps establish coverage needs of members. So for instance, drones, Johnny had made mention of drones. Drones, of course, it has just recently come on the scene, maybe within the last, 5 or 6 years. At the time, most insurance policies, if you had a flying aircraft, insurance policies don't cover that, right? And so we started to realize that some of the USIP members started to own drones, right? For fairgrounds, for search and rescue, for some of those things. So as we gathered that data, we realized that, hey, we need to perhaps change our coverage because flying aircraft is excluded, in the policy. So Johnny presented that to the board, and they were able to alter the coverage to accommodate coverage for USIP members. Same thing with number three here, assist USIP in determining training and risk management needs of members. you know, with drones. There's a lot of FAA regulations, and there's some things that go along with that. And so it helps us if we know that the drones, we started with 5 on our exposure schedule, and now we have, you know, 75 or 80. We know that maybe there's a training opportunity for us to be, because, you know, laws and things change. So that's a training opportunity for us to be able to present, you know, to you all if, you know, if there's some potential risk. And so one thing that I do want to say, and I should back up a little bit, is I want to thank all of you for, it's amazing to me how many vehicles that you're inputting, buildings, you know, payroll, all the things that you do, and how accurate it is. I mean, in the tens of thousands of things that are on the USIP schedules, very rarely do we catch something that, you know, perhaps there's a vehicle that has a zero value or something, some little minor mistake. But we really do sincerely appreciate all of your work and your help, and more importantly, just your accuracy with how you report. And so, so if we jump in, I just want to show really quick for those who aren't familiar with the exposure reporting. This is how you access the website. So each USIP member is at, on our website, of course. The way that you'd access it, you have this login button here on the top right corner. It'll say either USIP member, risk coordinator, or now we have a board of directors one as well. So of course you would click on the risk coordinator option, and then from there you'll get to this screen, and this will have all of the USIP members on here. And so you click on that, it'll ask for your password, and now it takes you to here. This is, of course, this is Beaver County's page. And so from there, you will click on schedules, and schedules will bring up a screen that's similar to this on the top. Some of you that are familiar with it realize that there's a couple, there's a few changes that we've made. And we'll get to those a little bit later, but I want to just go through a description. Because sometimes, I don't know if you guys have ever experienced it, where you might have an item that you're trying to add, and it sometimes will fit into two categories, and you're not quite sure where it goes. It could be mobile equipment. It could be a snowmobile. This is just kind of a brief definition of some of those. And I apologize, snowmobiles, we all know what that is. I don't know how you define, so motorized vehicle with runners and tracks used for traveling in snow. So there's, anyway, so this is just a definition sheet with all of them. Watercraft, if a boat is over 26 feet, let us know, because we're gonna have to address that. From a coverage standpoint, currently with our coverage, we don't cover boats over 26 feet. And so, if that is an issue at all, or if you run into that, let us know. We can address that. And so, so we have vehicles, trailers. Your mobile equipment is kind of tricky. I'm just going to read some of these off. So you've got your road equipment, your tractors, your backhoes, your loaders, all of that. Snowcats. I think the natural reaction would be, hey, I'm going to put that on snowmobiles. But we would actually rather see the big snowcats on mobile equipment. Unless it's licensed. If it's licensed for road use, and then we're going to want to put it on vehicles. You've got your motorcycles, and then payroll, exposures, drones, and then of course construction, and your ATV and utility vehicles. And so, I'm going to switch gears here and go into our testing website. These changes are not yet live on our system. They're in a test phase, and so I'm going to get into that, and I'm just going to walk through a few of these. Let's see here. this out. Where am I at here? Johnny Q.
This is a PC guy behind the Mac.
If we can't get to it, I want to. So this is our, again, this is our development site, and so let me put this in here, then we can jump into some of the changes. Okay, so this is what it will look like. I'm going to jump in first to the exposures and just go over one small change that we've made. With exposures, let's get into... Okay. So if we go into exposures... One change that's not on our test development site yet, but it will be, is in total expenditures. I know in the past you have had to put a number for the county's total expenditures. Now we will actually do that for you. We'll pull the information off of the transparency website, and whatever number you've reported to the state, that's what number we're going to put. On total expenditures. So that will eliminate at least one step. You can go through, as we go through this, you can see some of these that are grayed out. You've got payroll, drones, licensed vehicles. All of those, of course, they're pulled from other sections of the exposures website. So the ones that aren't grayed out, of course, are the ones that you'll have to fill in manually. So you've got jail cells, we've got if we jump up top, employees. Are there any questions on the employees? I know that there was a time where there were a few hiccups with how we reported employees. Are there any questions with how that reads and what we need to report with that? Okay. So if we go to here, to exposures, now I'm going to get into a couple of the tabs that will... Where we've made some changes. So let's go to let's go mobile equipment. Okay, on mobile equipment, if I go to add, you'll see a few changes that will a little bit of a variation from maybe what you're used to. Okay. So you have your make and model, of course, your year, serial number, and ID number. With here, we have a question now, and this will apply to vehicles, to mobile equipment. It'll ask you if it's leased or owned. And so you just click on that. In the past, I think we just asked if there's a lien holder, and you put yes or no. So that's just one change. Another big change that we've made is you'll see in the past where we have purchase price here, in the past we've put actual cash value. And the reason why we changed it to purchase price is I think that maybe there was a feeling of, hey, if it says actual cash value, each time I renew these exposures, each time I report in June, I'm going to change that because a vehicle, you know, of course, decreases in value. So now I'm going to change it to, it used to be $10,000, I'm going to change it to $8,000 and then $6,000 and so forth. We don't need any of those adjustments. We just need a purchase price, and then it will run with that. Randy?
On your leased or owned, we do lease purchases.
Okay.
Is that leased or owned? Because it's really just a financing mechanism?
Yes, yeah. You know, with the lease purchase, I would put lease on there. And, you know, to be honest with you, we see our reinsurance company, they're the ones that ask us for that information. As far as USIP purposes go, I don't believe that we really have need for that information, but our reinsurance company does. So, if you're doing a lease to own, I would still put lease. Is that, what do you think, Sonia?
Actually, I would say owned.
That's kind of what
I was. If it's leased to own, because you've taken possession of the vehicle, you have the vehicle, and it's in the process.
It's really just a mechanism of, it would be the same as if we just went out and did financed it. But the problem is in our government, they call it a lease purchase, but it's really just, yeah.
Okay, so if that's the case, Sonia, what would you say? When would a scenario come up that they would actually put lease?
Lease.
If they plan to turn that vehicle back at the end of the lease, then I think
then lease.
It's lease.
Okay.
If you know up front you're buying that vehicle, but you're just using the lease, like Brandy says, to finance it, then put it as owned.
So if your intention is to buy it at the end of the lease, put owned. If not, put leased. Okay. So that is pretty much it with the member section here. One thing too, a lot of these are going to be mandatory fill sections. So in the past, you may have been able to, say, skip the purchase price. Perhaps you were waiting on a value from the road department and you skipped that and just put zero and you were going to come back to it. With the new system, it won't allow you to do that. There are going to be columns or questions that require that you have all the information prior to adding it. And so if we jump to vehicles, let's see here. Vehicles has changed a decent amount as well. But again, they're essentially all the same. The same questions would have changed. Again, there's a lot of mandatory fill sections. I guess I need to get into the vehicles first, huh? Corby, while I'm doing it, tell an attorney joke. Okay, let's see here. So let's go in and add a vehicle. So vehicles has changed drastically. We and hopefully it's for the better too. Okay. We'll see if this is gonna go. If not, we'll jump over to the PowerPoint presentation.
Like I said, this is a city-owned facility, so they had to take the lowest bid on internet.
Okay, so if you're familiar with this site, in the past, you had member up here at the top, of course, and then below member, it would say type. And in a type, it would have, it would say licensed, trailers, right, watercraft, it'll say motorcycles, ATVs or all terrain.
Heavy trucks.
So all of that. So that drop down, we have removed that drop down in place. If I go to the top here, you can see now mobile equipment, motorcycles, snowmobiles, trailers, vehicles, watercraft. Those are all separate tabs now. That way you're not pulling it. And the reason we did that is because some questions vary. Watercraft, they want to know, they want different information on a watercraft opposed to a vehicle or mobile equipment. So we really had to separate those tabs in order to accommodate all the information that we need to collect and gather. So that's the one change. A lot of it's still the same. You have the department, so if it's a sheriff's department, road department, of course, just put that. VIN number, again, the leased or owned. And then, again, purchase price rather than actual cash value. And here is another difference. Now, gross vehicle weight, that's going to be removed. You're not going to have to get that. Before you get too excited, though, you still have to know the gross vehicle weight of it. And so, because with this category, we have the drop-down box here. So I have put this, let's see here. So in the past, we just had extra heavy truck or heavy truck, and then you're left to wonder, well, what's an extra heavy truck? What's a heavy truck? And so we've put the gross vehicle weight of that. So, of course, your half ton, your three-quarter tons, those are generally light trucks, right? You get into the one tons, and they could be still a light truck. It could possibly be a medium truck. And then you go up from there. With private passenger vehicles as well, SUVs have been a question. Is that a light truck? Some people consider it a light truck, or is it a private passenger? Oh, we'd like to see it as a private passenger with an SUV rather than a light truck. So, and then your vans, of course, those are all self-explanatory. And your ambulance, bus, all those, fire, private passenger, again, if it's an SUV, if it's a car, all of those things will go under here. So this category, it is actually a mandatory fill category as well, and I think it has been leading up to these changes too. So it will not allow you to continue until you have selected one of those. So let's see. Okay, so if we go here, so that we have kept these at the bottom, so plate number, if that's useful for you, we've kept those. Unit number, of course, the unit number is automatically going to transfer the last four of the digit of your VIN number over to your unit number. And then codes, that's kind of more of an in-house thing. If you have a categorizing system that you use, you can use codes to, just to be able to track different departments and what have you. So those are some of the changes that we made to vehicles. If I jump over here, mobile equipment is essentially the same. Looks like it's waiting. So we'll do mobile equipment, and then we'll jump over to watercraft. And there are a few new changes, new questions that they ask with watercraft. Sorry, this internet is pretty slow. Okay, so mobile equipment. Again, make, model, year, serial number, leased or owned, purchase price in place of actual cash value, and then department code. So fairly, you know, kind of follows a common theme with throughout vehicles. Motorcycles are the same. And then if we jump over to watercraft, I'll just show you a couple of the new questions that that have been added with watercraft. Okay, so we go here, we have make, model, length is a question that's new. So you'll want to find out the length of the boat. The next one is location of the bodies of water. So wherever that's located, wherever the boat is stored, we want to put that. And then description of use as well. So I think most boats are probably search and rescue, patrol, you know, those types of operations. And so description of use, if you put, you know, it's my Uncle Larry's weekend fishing boat or something, you might get one of Johnny's pictures going on. You might get a call from him. And so but all of that information is important for us to know and for our reinsurance companies to know. And so, and hopefully that's information that's fairly easy to obtain. So let's see here. So if we jump there.
Do we have to go back to our watercraft that's already on the schedule and put this information in?
That's a great question. No, we will have our programmers, they'll move all of that information over. So yeah, you won't have to go in and manage.
Like the length and bodies of water, you're not
gonna know. You know, yeah, if you're able to, I've tried to go through some of it, because there's really not a lot of watercraft that we have scheduled. I've tried to go through some of it, and some of it does have indication, okay, this is a 22 footer, and so I've added it in there. But yeah, if you don't mind going through, if you have that information. One thing too, our reinsurance company, they recognize that some of these changes and this information isn't gathered overnight. And so, you know, if you can update it as needed, that would be great. But I don't think that they expect this right now, right? You know. But the sooner the better, but it doesn't have to be right away. So,
Marty?
Yeah.
Can we search by code, by that code line? Will that be a searchable item, or is it still just going to be the VIN and the
year and whatever? How has code been in the past with it? Have you been able to search?
I don't think so, because we haven't used it that much.
The code, before. Okay.
If we have a separate identifier than what the VIN number is. In our books, but
well, are you thinking the unit number?
Okay.
Isn't there a unit number and code? Not in watercraft. Are you talking about vehicles, Steve?
Yeah, and the unit on the old one, the unit number was what was automatically filled with the VIN.
Right,
number.
And it's still there under vehicles.
But,
so that'll still be there. So when you get your list from the state,
so we started using.
Yeah, the state with the EX plates, they sort of by unit number, which is the last four of the VIN. Mm-hmm. So that's still there. That'll still automatically populate, right? Marty, we didn't take unit number.
No, unit number is still on there. You know, one thing too, there is you do have the ability to export it. So if you're, I don't believe that there's a search bar where you can look up a certain code for this, but kind of the workaround with that is just to export it to Excel, and then you can sort it by code. And so,
well, all of our, if you go back to vehicles,
okay,
or maybe it won't do it for you.
Let's try it.
Will this be in place for this year's renewal?
Yes.
It will. This will actually go live next Wednesday. And so this is, like I said, we're just working off of our kind of our test site right now. And so, and again, with, you know, where snowmobiles and trailers and motorcycles and watercraft and mobile equipment, ATVs, where currently those are all under vehicles, you, of course, don't have to worry about any of that. Our programmers will separate everything with snowmobiles, so you won't have to do anything that way.
Maybe it's not.
But all of the, if you remember, okay, so stop here, don't add. Yeah, just, can you go up, there you go. So all of, if you click on make, it sorts them alphabetically. So if you, in here, we don't have the unit number listed, Steve, so you couldn't sort it here by unit number, but all of those fields right there are sortable. If you click on make or click on model.
Yeah, so if I clicked on department, it's going to alphabetize those. And
so maybe just click on one of, over to the right too.
So there's.
Edit.
So.
Yeah, there you go.
It starts with those that
don't have a department. And then if you do edit, go into edit.
So there we go. So there's that, just backwards.
See, and this is our site, so it's got all of the members. So that's why it's so massive.
So you want edit?
Yeah, let's do edit. And then go down a little bit.
So there's our code right there.
Yeah, well, your unit number.
Yeah.
That's one of the state.
You're going to maintain that with the four-digit code. So we can use our unit number we use, we can put in the code line.
Yes, and that's why we left that code there. So okay. Some counties are sorting it. Yeah, I know you guys do. So a lot of the counties do use a specific code, and that's why we've left that for you. But yes, you can export it and then sort it by your code. Or you may call it a unit number.
Can you import it back in, or can you just export it?
No. You have to go in, you have to go in manually and change something. So if you've sorted it by your code and you have a change or something, then you'll just have to go into that and change it.
Yeah. Okay, that's it. You can see, of course, unit number, the last four digits of this VIN number is 8208, so unit number just automatically populates in 8208. So, okay, before I jump over to properties, are there any questions at all just on some of the changes? Nothing? Okay. So, let's see how we are for time here. 4:06. Okay. I'm gonna switch gears. I'm gonna close out of this and I'm gonna get back into
hover down at the bottom and I'll show up.
Where are we at here?
You're so successful in your country.
Okay. So let's go into property. Okay, so just a few changes with the property schedule format. I think this has a somewhere. Well, on properties, there's just a couple, there's actually three changes. You can see you have a property identifier number up at the top. Prior to that, we had just an appraisal number. And so if you're adding a property, there is no need to fill out the property identifier number. That's something that we'll do on the back end. So you can leave that blank if you're adding something. Let's see here. I need to get to the next one, so we have building, that's been there before, content, electronic data processing equipment. The one change with fine arts, and we don't have a whole lot of fine arts to schedule, but with fine arts, under the coverage addendum, in LUS, fund are specifically kind of endorsed or added to the schedules. So a painting, a statue, something like that. If it exceeds $10,000, you'll want to have it appraised. And then you want to download that appraisal. And so we'll have something where a tab that will have upload appraisal, and you'd put the total dollar amount, and then you could upload multiple appraisals for that, just to make sure that we're aware of them and we have, you know, the proper coverage in place. The next one is property in the open. Johnny had made mention of this, so that's your lamppost, your fences, your if you have statues. Our appraiser will now begin to collect property in the open. Every 5 years, UCIP members will, the entire county or building or exposures will be appraised. And so as your appraisal comes around, the appraiser will calculate the property in the open. Now they're not going to add that to the building value. They'll actually take, if the building value is generally $300,000, it's not going to increase the building value, if that makes sense. So if there's $10,000 in property in the open, and the building is worth $300,000, it's going to equal out. I guess I didn't explain that very well, but property in the open and building will just be combined, and your amount or your dollar figure isn't going to increase at all. And so the last one, and this will be a gray fill, it's total, and that's again just something from our reinsurance company. They're essentially just adding up contents, building, fine arts, miscellaneous, property in the open, and they're coming up with a total value for the entire building. Contents included. So that is what we have there. And then I'm running out of time, but from here on out, if I go back here, you're going to have a hyperlink. If you're not sure what falls under what the definition of contents or EDP or fine arts or miscellaneous or property in the open, you're going to be able to hover over a link and it'll give you that definition. So fine arts, it's going to give you a long definition of what fine arts is, just so there's no confusion to where you're not putting an item in a different category. It'll give you a definition of EDP, property in the open. And so with this screen, this is just kind of a brief definition of contents, EDP. Fine arts, of course, is a little bit longer of a definition because there's more involved with that. That comes directly out of our coverage addendum. And then miscellaneous is floating contents. If you have a building that there's contents, the contents are generally tied to that building. There are some cases where you have contents that are kind of floating, that aren't always at a certain location. And so in that case, you put it under miscellaneous, where it's kind of floating contents. And then property in the open is essentially just signs, fences, lampposts, etc. So that's really it for that. But more than anything, we just want to put definitions so you have a clear idea of what category the item that you're scheduling goes into. So with properties, that is that's essentially it for that. And I think I'm just about out of time. Yes.
We just installed security cameras throughout the county. Would
you put each location security equipment in? So like the Haven has a certain amount, and the Haven has a certain amount, or just put it somewhere else in one security system?
Yeah,
I would include that in contents. I would include it in contents of each building. Yeah, so if it's a $5,000 security system, I just bump up the contents coverage. So,
yeah, our appraisers, or the appraisers that come out,
will they catch them?
They kind of have a formula. As they're going through, they kind of look at everything that's in the building, and so they will include that in each building. So, yes,
inside and outside. Oh, okay.
Yep.
And unless you have something extraordinary in your county, like you put in, most counties would have a $5,000 security system in their building, and you've gone with the $500,000 security system. What the way that they handle contents and the way that they'll handle the property in the open is based on the type of building that it is and the usage of it. They do county buildings and city buildings all over the U.S., thousands and thousands of them. So they'll take the average contents of a 30,000 square foot courthouse used for office, you know, at county administration. They'll take their average countrywide of what the contents in a building like that is, and that's what they'll assign for contents for your